Hey, Brent Porcio, topwassy.net. Gonna do this video on short arm pass, or the short arm cock position to a more long position. So I guess short versus long arm pass. You know, it's hard when you hear a lot of conventional wisdom that doesn't really fit into what you understand when you really start to understand biomechanics, but I really can see where a lot of these players and coaches are coming from when they're talking about this. So this is gonna be my interpretation of it, and I'm gonna do my best to take the science and the biomechanics and get you to understand it. So a short arm pass would be, obviously I'm thinking someone who is in a more flexed position, like a catcher, and when they cock their arm, they could even cock it earlier. A long arm would be someone in a more extended arm position, maybe past 90, that it looks like it's reaching back farther. I'm sure that's the impression that we're getting. And how does that work? Would you take someone who's a short arm, and if you don't like the short arm, would you make them a long armer? Or if it's a long arm, you don't like the long arm, would you make a short arm? Or which arm's better? Because we see these pro guys throw really hard with the short arms, but then we see these other pro guys throw really hard with the long arms. Now, that's I get all that, that's important. But the thing is, it really is, the short arm to long arm, or the arm path, really is dependent on the kinetic chain. It's really dependent on how the body is moving overall, and its ability to move and its ability to function. So that's why you see variances in it at a high level. It's because you're looking at different body types. So let's really understand this. Someone would have a short arm path that it works well for them. This is not someone that doesn't work well for. If someone has a short arm, more flexed arm that works well for them, they're gonna be people that are very rotational. When I say rotational, it's gonna be someone that typically has a more rotating lower half with the hips, and then typically that usually follows with a more rotating trunk. So if I'm more rotating, things move into rotation at higher speeds, and typically where you have high speeds of rotation, you have a lot of centrifugal force. Everything wants to fly away, right? So if you don't want your arm flying or dragging around, what are you gonna do? You're gonna simply just pull it in, right? You're gonna pull it in, you're gonna fight that centrifugal force to be able to maintain that arm slot. And that's a lot of what happens with guys that get very inside 90. They're so rotational, they're trying to fight all that centrifugal force to keep their arm slots somewhere consistent to the plate. So you can take those guys that are very rotational with those inside 90 slots, and you can start to open them up and relax them more. It might help. But eventually, if it gets too long and they're those quick rotators, now their arm's in that drag that they were trying to avoid, and more than likely, their ball's flying all over the place, okay? So just the focus here is if you're trying to change the arm path, understand it and then do it through the trunk, or do it through the kinetic chain, not through the arm. So those long arm guys, they really lean back far, and then they slowly can carry their trunks forward, and that's why those long arm paths work. Because if they had a short arm path, and they kept the arm back, and they turned, and then this thing popped out, and then all of a sudden they're pushing the ball well before their trunk goes forward. That long arm path is gonna work better. So just start categorizing a long arm is more, that's more common to a more linear trunk, and a short arm, or inside 90, is more common to a rotational trunk, okay? And make your adjustments from there. So if for some reason you wanna make every pitcher you have this perfect just inside 90 slot, well, you're gonna have to make them have the same trunk path of that perfect example that you're using, in the same lower half and hip path, which dictates a lot of the trunk movements before you get to the arm. And so that, I think that's the best way to understand it. Not one is better than the other. It's just really dependent on your trunk and your kinetic chain. Ideally for me, I'm gonna optimize your kinetic chain. If I see you have more room to separate, you have more room to drive and create more momentum towards the target, I'm gonna open those things up. And if you were, because you were so rotational, you were inside 90, now I can relax and get you more to 90 or just inside 90, and let things get a little longer if you want. That's gonna be the way I'm gonna do it. I'm just gonna take you and find out how to use both really well. Like in the top velocity approach, 3X pitching, we're trying to optimize linear and rotational energy. We want really rotational energy to complement linear energy, because linear energy is taking us to the target. So if I'm optimizing both, I'm gonna be someone probably just inside 90. And that perfect to 90 arm slot, riding a really optimal kinetic chain, that's the goal. So be careful getting in the short arm to long arm argument. because both sides are gonna win. And at the end of the day, it's just truly understanding the kinetic chain and why that pitcher's doing that and what would be best for them to optimize their kinetic chain and free up their arm path.